Now, very good morning. So today we will be covering the second part of the PEG Propagation Neural Network. In the first part, we covered a working example of the PEG Propagation Neural Network, but we didn't cover how the chain rule works, how that formula comes in. So we use that formula directly. I'm Dr. Pankaj Agarwal, professor, IMS Engineering College. So for this example, I'll be taking this sample example. Where we have taken two inputs in the input layer. We have taken two hidden layers and we have two neurons in the hidden layers, and we have taken two neurons in the output layer. And we have considered the input value to be, this is just a sample value. This is 0.0105 and another is 0.10. And the corresponding target values are what? 0.01 and 0.99. And we have also considered a set of random weights corresponding to the input and hidden layers. So these are the weights, right? And we have also considered the weights corresponding to the hidden and the output layers. So we have these set of weights. And we have also considered a set of bias values corresponding to hidden inputs. And we have also considered the bias values corresponding to the output layer, right? So the problem is, like, we have the input, and for this corresponding input, what we need to do is, so we have this input 0.05 and 0.10, and the corresponding target are, suppose, 0.01 and 0.99. So the first phase, as we have discussed, would be the forward phase, right? And mind you that we are using the logistic function, as we discussed in the previous slide also, right? So the first part is, so to begin with, what we have to do is, we have to first calculate the activation input for these hidden inputs and the corresponding output for these hidden inputs. And then these output of all, both the hidden inputs would become the input for these output inputs, right? And then we would be calculating the output for, similarly for output one and output two, right? And then it would end the mark of the forward phase. So let us first do the forward phase. We also call it as what? Forward pass. So in the forward pass, what we need to do is just describe that we need to calculate the net input for each of the hidden inputs. So let's do it for H1 first. So for net input, we always know that it is nothing but the summation of your Xi into Wi. So since we have two weights, so the formula becomes what? W1 into I1 and W2 into I2. And since we have also included the bias value, so we would also have the bias. As we all know that the bias is always a dummy input with the value of one, right? So this one comes from the, it is not included as a input value, right? It only includes a bias weight, right? So B1 is that bias weight. So the net input, defined by this above formula, when we calculate it, it comes out to be 0.377, right? And since this is the net input, so next step, as we all know, we have to apply what? The activation function. And since the activation function that we have considered in this example is what? Sigmoid function. So by applying the sigmoid function, and we all know that sigmoid function does what? It basically converts your net input into the range of 0 and 1. So for this corresponding input, for net input H1, so we get the output corresponding to output of H1, which comes out to be 0.5. So similarly, we need to calculate the output corresponding to the next hidden unit, that is H2, right? So doing the same manner, assuming that we have understood this formula, so we would be calculating H2 also. So after calculating H2, the value comes out to be 0.59 here, right? So the next task is what? The next task is that we have got the output for H1 and H2. Now we need to calculate the output for O1 and O2. So this output of H1 and H2 that we just got becomes the input for O1 and O2, right? So for calculating the net input for O1, the formula would be what? The formula would be your H1 into W5, right? Plus H2 into W6, and plus the bias weight, which is over here is 0.6. So by applying this same formula, so what we are doing is, first we are calculating net input of output one by applying the formula which I have just described, right? So after solving this, the value comes out to be 1.1, right? And by applying the activation function in the same manner, So the final value of this output 1, that is the output neuron 1, comes out to be 0.75. And in the same way, we can calculate the output value of the second output neuron, that is O2, which comes out to be 0.77. So I hope the formula was very clear in the first example also. So after this particular forward phase, so what we have achieved is we have calculated the output of both the output neurons. And mind you, for both the output neurons, we were given what? We were given a target value also, right? And if you remember, now the second part of this algorithm says what? We need to calculate the error. Calculate the error with respect to what? Respect to the calculated output, that is these two values that we have calculated, right? And the target value which were already taken into account at the beginning of the initialization of the network. So, and once we calculate the error, those errors are get back propagated in the backward fashion. That is, we need to update each and every weight first between the hidden and the output, and then between what? The input and the hidden, right? So that comes out to be the next phase, right? So the first task at this point of time is to calculate the error for both the inputs, that is for O1 as well as for O2, right? So that is the calculating the total error. So the total error, as we are aware that we would be following what? The total error would be the sum squared errors, right? So the sum squared errors, that is the target minus of output whole square. And since we had what, two output units, so we would be calculating for both the output units, we would be calculating the error, right? The value half which has been taken over here is because we would be using the derivative of this total error when we would be doing the gradient descent function, or we would be applying this gradient descent algorithm. So we would be taking what? The derivative, first order derivative of this error. And just to cancel out the effect of 2, we have taken this half. Otherwise, this half is not going to make much difference, right? So as an example, so we have calculated the output. So first thing that we are doing is calculating the error corresponding to output 1. So we have just described this formula, target minus of output. The target value was in the initial, it was given what? For output 1, it was given 0.01, right? And 0.75 is just the calculated output that we have done right now. So this is the difference, and then after solving it, 0.27 comes out to be the error corresponding to the output 1. In the same fashion, we can calculate the output, output error for corresponding the unit 2, that is O2, right? So these two errors now would be summed up in order to get the total error. So total error is nothing but the sum of the errors corresponding to each and every output units that we have. Since we had what, two output units here, so we have calculated the error corresponding to both the units. So the total error which comes out over here is what? This is the value, that is 0.298, right? Now, this is the end of the phase 2. So phase 1, we had the forward phase, and the phase 2, we had what? The calculation of the error. Now the third phase begins what? The third phase, we have to back propagate this total error so that we can update all the weights. First between hidden and the output, and then with respect to the hidden and the input, right? So that is what we are going to do in this particular phase. So this was the network we were considering, right? So the backward phase starts. So the backward phase will do one thing. So we have just calculated the total error, right? So the first task is to update these weights, right? So for example, we will take one example to show that how this weight W5 would be updated. And then in the same manner, we would be updating all these weights. Mind you, we cannot update the weight directly between input and the hidden. We need to first update the weight between your output and the hidden event, right? So that is what we are trying to do. So we will explain that how this W5 is getting updated, right? And that is where the chain rule would come into play. So the total error, so what we need to actually calculate is what? Mathematically, we need to calculate the rate of change of total error that we just calculated with respect to W5. That what is the rate at which the total error would be updated or would get changed with respect to W5. So what is the contribution of W5 with respect to the total error? That is what we actually mean. So this del E by del W5, we can also read it as what? Partial derivative of E total, right? And we can also, this is what actually is called the gradient. So we call it as a gradient. So gradient of the gradient error with respect to the weight W5, right? So this is how we can formulate it. So so what we need to do is we need to calculate the value of E total with respect to W5. Now there is a hitch over here. The thing is this E total, that is the total error that we calculated, and W5. Now W5 cannot see this error directly because W5 is sitting over here. It cannot see the error which was calculated from here. It does not know how to. There is no correlation between W5 and E total. So we need to find some way so that we can, because we have to find the rate of change, because there is no associated value with respect to W5 in comparison to E total. So we cannot find the rate of change of E total with respect to W5. So what we do is we came up with a chain rule, right? So what we did is, so start reading from the right to left, right? Over here also. So this E total, that is the total error. Now this total error, we can find the rate of change of this total error with respect to this output unit one, definitely, right? Because we just calculated the error with respect to this output one only, right? So we can always find the rate of change of this total error with respect to this unit out one, right? So that is what the first term has been reduced, right? That is rate of change of total error with respect to the output unit one, right? Now, this similarly, we can always say that we can always find the rate of change of the output one with respect to net input O1, isn't it? So that is where the next term also comes into play. That is the rate of change of the total output with respect to the net input O1, right? Because both the terms are associated. So we can always find the rate of change. And the third term is what? The third term over here is the rate of change of the net input, that is output, net input O1 with respect to W5. Now, since now this W5 is associated with this net input output one, so we can always find the rate of change of net output one with respect to W5. So if you are going to see it carefully, these three terms which have been introduced, when we are going to solve it mathematically, they are nothing but the same thing that we need to calculate it. That is the total error with respect to the W5. And just to calculate this term, these three terms were introduced. And that is what, and the introduction of these three rules basically, or these three terms basically comes up with something called chain rule. So that is what we mean it by chain rule, right? Now, so in order to calculate the total error with respect to W5, we have to first calculate these three terms independently, right? So this E total was actually the formula. This was the formula for E total. It was the one combination was your error one, another combination was your error two, right? So we have expanded the formula of E total in this way. Okay. So the first thing that we need to calculate, the first term that we have to calculate is what? E total with respect to output one, right? So E total with respect to the output one, we need to differentiate it. See, we need to differentiate these two terms. Now, with respect to what? Output one. And if you see that there's no term output one in the right hand side of this particular term, right? So once we are going to differentiate this right hand side with respect to output one, the value would be zero. So this value zero has come because there was no differentiating term called output one, right? And for the rest of the part, once we're going to differentiate it, we're going to get this particular value, right? That 2 would come over here, and the effect of 2 would be cancelled out by taking the half that we discussed earlier, and 2 minus 1, and minus 1 because we had the term output 1, but it was associated with a negative value. So this minus 1 has been introduced. So I hope you will know that how to differentiate it. So what we have calculated is what? We have calculated the E total with respect to output 1 at this point of time. So the first component has been calculated, which comes out to be a value 0.74. So you have to just remember this formula. So this formula is important because we would be then accumulating all the three terms and put them into a formula the way we did it in the first example, right? In the previous example, that point of time, we used that formula directly. So this is the first term that we would be taken into the formula, right? Now the second term which we need to calculate is what? Now we have to calculate the net output, that is output one, with respect to net output one, right? So we have to calculate which term. We need to calculate this term, this value, right? The rate of change of the net output with respect to the rate of change of what? The net input one. See? So now, which is the output one has been defined by this formula. That is, the total output is nothing but the sigmoidal function with respect to your net input, right? So once we are going to differentiate this net output one with respect to net output one, so we would be getting this formula. And again, this is the second component that we need to remember. And by solving it, the value comes out to be 0.18, right? Now we are left with what? One more term. Now we need to calculate what? The net output, net input, sorry, one with respect to del 5. That is the rate of change of the net input with respect to your weight 5 that we were taking, right? Now the net input one, as we all know, is nothing but this particular formula. We have already covered this, right? So again, we have expanded this, and then we have to differentiate it with respect to W5. And since there was no term W5 in this part, right? And this part, the only term which comes out to be useful is this part. So it would result into the value of what? It would result into the value of output H1, which comes out to be the value of 0.5 that we have already calculated, right? So what we have done is, by putting all these three calculations, so we would get a value like this. So this is what the E total, that is rate of change of the total error with respect to your W5, right? So if you're going to put this into a formula, so this is the formula that I was talking about, and that this is the same formula that we used in the previous example. So we have to use this formula directly in order to calculate the rate of change of error with respect to the weight W5. And in the same way, what we can do is, we can do this, we can calculate the error, the total rate of change of error with respect to all the weights that were there. That is, now this rate of change of error will introduce one more component, because we have to find the new weight, right? So the formula for defining the new weight is what? The old weight, W5 is the old weight, this is the learning rate. So we have taken the learning rate to be, for example, 0.5. This can be any value, right? Between the range of 1 and 5, or 0 and 1. And this is the value that we have just calculated. So after calculations, we would get what? The new weight with respect to the old weight is this value, right? And in the same manner, we have to calculate the weights W6, W7, and W8. Plus means over here is the new weight, right? So what we have done is, we have calculated the new updated weights between your output and the hidden weights. The next task would be definitely to calculate the new weights or the updated weights with respect to your hidden and the input unit, right? So the next weight, we have already done with this. So the next term is what? Let's do, we have calculated this. So we calculated these values. Right. Now, the next thing is that we need to calculate the rate of change of the total error with respect to what? W1, right? So because this is the weight between input and the hidden unit, right? Now, in order to calculate the total error with respect to the del W1, so we can express this in this form, right? Again, the chain rule, the same chain rule that we did, right? Now, this total, this term can further be expanded in this form, because this total error was made up of two terms. That is error one and error two, right? Isn't it? So the first thing that we need to calculate is what? This particular term, that is error one, and this particular term. So we need to calculate these two terms separately. So after calculating these two terms, starting with the del of E with respect to output H1, right? And we can calculate, see, we have already done the formula, so I suppose you would be able to calculate these terms again, right? And since the net output O1 is defined by this formula, so net output by output of H1 would come out to be W5 equal to this. So we have to just plug in the same formulas that we did the previous step. So similarly, by following the same process, we have calculated the del of this output error E2 with respect to the output O1, right? So again, we have got this value. So we have to record these kind of values, right? And similarly, we have calculated the del of output H1 with respect to the net input H1, which comes out to be this. And then finally, your net output H1 with respect to the W1, which comes out to be 0.05. Since you have understood this, I suppose you would be able to plug in the values. So so what we have got is this new value of this rate of change of the total error with respect to W1. So in order to get the new value of W1, so same by same funda, the old value of W1 minus of rate, this learning rate, and then the rate of change that we did just now. So this is the new updated value of W1. In the similar manner, we have to calculate W2, W2, W3, and W4 also, right? So I hope you would be able to plug in these values. So what we see out of the entire context is that, so for a given input, we calculated some error in the forward phase, right? Then we back propagated those errors so that we updated all the weights, right? And once we updated all the weights, then we can start putting the same input that we took in the first phase. And then we would again doing the forward phase and would be calculating the error. Now, in this process, the overall task is to minimize this error. And we have to look for iteration. We have to wait for a convergence scale where this error gets minimized or becomes null. Normally, the error never becomes null. We have to define the percentage of error or percentage of acceptable error, right? So this could be the case, for example, in this case, if we are going to run this for suppose 10,000 times. So after that, the error would become almost 0.00035. So which is about what? 99% similar to the target. So we need to define these kind of similarity pattern with respect to target, at what point of time we are going to converge the values. So this is a working example. I hope you able to understand that how the back propagation works and how the chain rule has been used in back propagation. So thank you for your time. Thank you.